majesty, let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. It trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God. Age to age, he stands. All time is in his hand. Beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one. The Father, the Spirit, and the Lamb. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God. How great, how great is our God. And all the world will see, all the world will see how great is our God. How great is our God. How great is our God. That's above every other name. Sing with me, how great is our God. How great, how great is our God. He is a great God.
Thank you, Minister Charmaine, for reminding us of how great God is. That's why we're here. And I'm going to invite you to join me as we ask God's blessing on the ministry of the Word so we can hear what God has to say to the church today. Speak, Lord. Your servant is listening. Your people need a word. But we know that we need your anointing to hear what the Spirit is speaking to the church. We need your anointing to proclaim your truth. So it's not just our opinion or our speech. We want to proclaim your truth and anoint our hearts, God, not to be indifferent, not to be resistant, but to be receptive to your voice, to your presence, to your promise, open to our future as appointed in your word. Make us doers of your word and not hearers only. It's our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And he gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. For the past 5 Sundays, we have looked into the leadership gifts that Jesus gave to the church as outlined here before us in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11. We've looked at the leadership gifts as Jesus modeled them during his earthly ministry. We've explored Jesus as an apostle, Jesus' evangelistic ministry, Jesus the good shepherd, Jesus the prophet, the prophetic voice, and Jesus the teacher. He gave leaders to the church, and he showed us how to lead. For what purpose? Verse 12. I have before me intentionally, don't often do this, but I'm very intentional this morning about the King James Version that says, he gave them for the perfecting of the saints, comma. You might say, well, what difference does a comma make? Well, a comma can make a whole lot of difference. And in my research and preparation for this message, believe it or not, I found and read an entire exegetical paper on this passage where the person who wrote it mostly focused on the comma. And I was convinced. At first, I was skeptical. I said, what difference could a comma make? The modern Bible translation, if you have NIV or any of the other modern versions, it will say, equipping the saints for the work of ministry. And that's not wrong, but it's different. If you say equipping the saints for the work of ministry, that's different than saying that Jesus gave these leaders to do 3 things: for perfecting of the saints, comma, for the work of ministry, comma, for the edifying of the body of Christ, colon. And then it goes on because it's kind of a long sentence. Let me share with you what Robert Mays was the author of this extended commentary on this passage. And let me share with you. He's focusing on the comma and also the word that in the King James it says perfecting. And we always have a problem with that word perfecting, don't we? Because it makes it sound like the saints are supposed to be perfect. But it doesn't say for the perfect saints. It's for perfecting the saints, which implies that this is the other thing we have a problem with, that the saints are somehow imperfect, which they must be. Because if they were already perfect, you wouldn't be perfecting. But when they are, when we are being perfected, do we arrive at a point of flawlessness? So, you know, perfection is kind of a difficult word. And so equipping, it sounds better, doesn't it? Equipping the saints, it sounds better. But here's the problem. That Greek word that gets translated as perfecting and also gets translated as equipping, listen to this. That word was originally a medical term that described the healing and mending of broken bones. Now, let me just give you a little bit of prayer. I'm going to resume this quotation, but just one little insight if you're following this argument. I'm not just making a grammatical semantic argument here. The anthropologists who study the history of human culture will say that one of the clearest signs of a human civilization is when they find remains of people who've had broken bones. The point is, if you have a broken leg, for instance, if you're in some kind of civilized setting, somebody's going to help you get that broken leg healed. And so if the bone break, you know, if you've ever had a broken bone and you had medical treatment, you line it back up and it'll knit itself back together, but you always be able to tell it had been broken. But if the one with the broken leg is abandoned, then they will die if they are not helped. In other words, when human beings, we organize ourselves to take care of people who are broken, that's a sign of civilization, apart from religion. But in the absence of, when you find people with broken bones and they just die like that, it meant that they were not sufficiently organized and civilized to care for those who are broken. So the word equip is, so the word, you see, I'm trying to show you the word that is before us as equipping. Equipment isn't exactly the accurate translation. It's a word that means mending of brokenness. It also was used in architectural discussions for the completion or repair of a building project, such as the Jerusalem temple or the walls of a city after a siege. So if a walled city is besieged, then the wall is broken. The whole story of Nehemiah is about rebuilding the broken wall. So that word is appropriate in that architectural setting. In clothing design, that word describes a finished, completed garment. In pottery, it refers to the shaping and completion of a potted vessel. And we know about the potter. That's another strong image from the Old Testament prophet, the potter, that we are clay, and the potter is shaping us into a particular kind of completion. And in pharmaceutical language, to refer to the perfect completed mixture of ingredients for a healing remedy. Now, if you, like me, take prescription medication for some health reasons, the thing that you take, somebody had to mix it. You know, the pharmacy dispenses it, but there's some preparation of that pharmaceutical. Now, there are people say, I don't take medicine. But if you don't take medicine, you take something when you have an ailment. And that thing, you know, some of us are subscribers to herbal remedies, and some of them are very effective. But there's always some kind. You got to mix something. It's that when that thing that is mixed to create a healing remedy, that's the word, that remedy, that pharmaceutical remedy is bringing healing to some kind of brokenness. So when we translate that word, the chief meaning is best seen as becoming complete and perfect. Now, elsewhere in the Gospels, you recall that when Jesus started his ministry, he called fishermen. Fishermen were first that he called. And James and John were in their fishing boat before they were called. But what were they doing? They were mending their nets. Same word. They were mending their nets. The torn and broken fragments were put back together and made whole. So this is the whole point of this. There's a whole paper on this, but this is what point I'd like to share with you. Equipping is not handing out tools and teaching the saints how to use them. I think most of the time, because I've used this verse many, many times. I love this verse. And I think this is one of the most important verses for the ministry of Christian education. Use it all the time. In fact, years ago when I was on the board of Christian education for the Church of God, I tried to convince them to adopt this verse as the theme for the whole denomination. I failed, but I tried. But I'm just saying, I think that equipping the saints, I love the idea of we're giving people tools and teaching them how to use them. The only problem is that's not an accurate translation of what this is. So, equipping is good. Educating is good. Giving people tools is good. Teaching them how to use it is good. It's just not what this is saying. Instead, it means healing the broken bones of the saints. Mending what is torn in the fabric of the fellowship. Medicating the pain of people by preaching Jesus. The perfecting of the saints means healing the brokenness of the saints. The perfect, King James talks about the perfect man is one whose broken bones have been healed. And can I just tell you again, if you've ever had a broken leg, broken arm, broken toe, broken finger, there's no substitute for time. Okay? You can have all the best medical treatment, have it perfectly set, have a cast or a wrap or what, do whatever. Because sometimes you break, like you break your ribs, Vince, you can't put a cast on it. But whatever that bone is, you may have, but sometimes you, yeah, break your hip, you got to have surgery. Different bones require different treatment, but there's no, it takes time. So you have treatment, but time and patience, and in time, it will grow back. It will be healed. That body will heal itself, but you have to set the broken bones. So this has everything to do with the Son of God and why he came to equip us, to perfect us, to mend us, and to heal us. Prophet Isaiah 53, verse 5 said, he was wounded for our transgression, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole. And by his bruises, by his stripes, we are healed. So, see, sometimes as saints, it's hard for us to think of ourselves as broken. And so we hide our brokenness or we deny it. or we pretend like it's not there, or we hope nobody notices. But the Bible says he was wounded for us. And so Jesus himself was broken. But in his brokenness, because he was the Son of God, we experience healing. And so, if you follow this comma and you follow this interpretation of the word equipping and perfecting as a word that signifies healing of brokenness, then you will see that Jesus gave church leaders, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers, to do the work of ministry. And it may sound like a subtle difference. The role of the pastor or the leader is not just to equip the saints to do the work of ministry, but to heal the saints and then do the work of ministry. Now, another commentary, this time by someone I know, or I've met before, John Collins, he says that the work of ministry, diakonia, I'm not good on the Greek, but I think that's right. That word is used to depict the service that is done by a representative of a higher authority, such as by a prime minister. We don't use that terminology, prime minister, in the United States. But many other countries, a minister, if you say minister, they don't think of clergy. They think of somebody who serves in a high appointment and responsibility in the government. We just don't use that word that way in the United States. But minister is a governmental servant who answers to the head of state. And so his point is that there are people who are appointed to leadership. Now, we can call it ordination, we can call it anointing, we can call it commissioning, but there are people who must answer to God for their leadership, just like a minister has to answer to the head of state. And it's not, ministry is not just doing stuff. Ministry is fulfilling your assignment, what God has assigned you to do as a leader in the body of Christ. So the leadership that Jesus gives and models for us has a threefold purpose: to heal broken people, to make ministry work, and to edify or build up the body of Christ. Our responsibilities as saints and as leaders, then, is to grow. What we're supposed to do is grow. And in fact, we grow and we're supposed to grow up. Now, grow and grow up is two different things. Growth signifies a maturity from childhood to adolescence to adulthood. And then you're grown. But everybody who's grown isn't finished growing up. Grow up means that you're good and grown. And you have a self-awareness of your adulthood. And that you no longer have the license to behave as if you are a child or an adolescent. So the body of Christ, what we want to see is people growing, and we want to see grown-ups. But we also want to see, this is the plan of God that the Son of God set up in the church. Fix the church, send leaders, organize the church for people to grow up, to speak up, to build up the body of Christ. And so what must we do? Now, this is not just for the leaders. This is the agenda for everybody in the church: to grow in unity and love. And those that, who gonna disagree with unity and love? Okay, we all agree with it, but do we do it? Do we have unifying conversations and engagements? Do we love? Do we practice love? Do we understand how love works? We must grow. In other words, you don't automatically know how to do unity. You don't automatically know how to do love. And so we're in the church. It's a community where people are growing in unity and growing in love, growing together toward the light that Christ Jesus gives us. We're growing toward the light. We also, in the body of Christ, the way we're organized, the way that God has positioned leaders, the model that we get from the ministry of Jesus Christ himself is to know the Son of God. All of our ministries, without exception, should focus on helping us know the Son of God. Everybody's not a preacher. Everybody's not a teacher. Everything we do is not worship. But everything we do in the church, everything we organize ourselves do, everything we fund and give for, ought to have some contribution to helping us to know the Son of God. Not just preach about him, but to know him. We also have a mandate to grow up using him, that is, the Son of God, and not ourselves as the measure of our progress. It's just human nature to compare ourselves with each other. But this scripture, this passage of scripture specifically says that we measure our progress by the stature of the fullness of Christ. It's kind of I've always kind of had a difficult time. I always am kind of stumped by that language. When you get to verse 13, 14, 15, the language gets a little complicated, especially in the King James. But Ephesians chapter 4, verse 13, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, that is, that's what we're supposed to be doing, united in faith, knowing the Son of God, unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. The measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. The measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Well, what does that mean? Here's what I think it means. That we should grow to the same height or stature as Jesus. Now, how can we do that? Because we don't know how tall or how short Jesus was. The Bible doesn't tell us. We don't know if Jesus could have been 7 feet tall for all we know, but they probably would have said that if he were. Only time the Bible really talks about height, well, we know like how tall Goliath was because he was a giant, right? But Jesus could have been, we know Zacchaeus was short, but we still don't know. We don't know if Jesus was short or tall or in between. We just don't know. And so he said, well, we need to grow up so that the stature is the height, right? And so that should be our goal. We don't measure ourselves by, well, I'm taller than this one or shorter than that one, but how do we all relate to the stature of Christ? Well, here's the way I see it. Well, nobody can change your height. The Bible even tells us that. You can't add to your height. Now, what you can do, you can't make yourself taller or shorter. You can put on some stilettos. In fact, you can give yourself 5-6 inches with stilettos or platform shoes. You can get about maybe 3 inches on the platform, right, maybe 4 inches on platform. You can put on some shoes to make yourself look taller, but then make you taller. It'll make you taller than somebody else who doesn't have those shoes on. But it doesn't make, you can't make yourself taller. Now, you can make yourself fatter. You can make yourself skinnier. You can adjust your weight, but you can't adjust your height once you've come to maturity. Now, if you're not mature, you're going to keep growing. But there's a certain point which you're going to stop. And you can't determine what your height is going to be. If you live long enough, The aging process will cause you to shrink, and you'll lose some inches, and you probably take off those stilettos too as you get old, and put on some flat shoes. It's a little safer. So we can shrink, but you don't want to control that. Because if you had a choice, you'd rather not shrink, right? You'd rather hold. So I'm saying you can't control your height. So how do we measure up to the stature of Christ? The measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ then doesn't refer to physical height. We know that Jesus reached his full potential as the Son of God, regardless of how tall or short he was physically. So every one of us should grow to our full height. Be as tall as you're supposed to be in him by reaching our full potential as a member of the body of Christ. Each of us should invite and expect and allow the Son of God to heal our brokenness so that we can grow, so that we can grow into our vocation, so we can discern our kingdom purpose. Just like Jesus, the Son of God, grew into and fulfilled his assignment. Now, I know we have different ideas about Jesus' awareness of his assignment, but what I see in the scriptures is that Jesus is Son of God. He's God and he's man. But he had a process of growth. In fact, the Bible does say the child grew. He grew. He didn't come all fully equipped and ready. He grew. He had stages of development, and he grew fully into his assignment. And so if Jesus grew fully into his assignment as the Son of God, the church is set up to nurture us, to support us, to help us to grow into our assignment, to be discerning of our role, how we participate, how we contribute to the health of the body as people who are being healed of our brokenness. Each of us then should invite this, should expect this, and should allow it. You know, the word allow for me, I say allow, you allow for the equipping. Sometimes when you have something that really hurts, like a broken bone, you don't want anybody to touch it. And they might have to do something, restrain you or sedate you in order to treat you. And so even if you acknowledge that you're hurt, it's a different thing to allow for your hurt to be healed. And that requires humility, that requires trust, that requires faith. And sometimes we get pushed to the limit before we will allow, before we will admit, before we acknowledge that we need help and we can receive it. Jesus fulfilled the measure of his stature is that he fulfilled what he was chosen and anointed to do. And so when we grow up into the measure of the fullness, the stature of Christ, that means we grow up not trying to be like somebody else, trying to do you, trying to be you. What does God call you to do? We all have vocation. We are not all ordained to be leaders and pastors and apostles and prophets. We're not all ordained to leadership, but we all have vocation. We all have calling. And we all are challenged to grow up. And once we grow up in this way, Then it continues, verse 14. Then we will no longer be little children, tossed and carried about by all kinds of teachings that change like the wind. We will no longer be influenced by people who use cunning and clever strategies to lead us astray. Did you realize that back in the Bible days, that was going on then? Some of us thought they just now figured out how to deceive and use and manipulate religious people to do things. But they was going on then. Instead, as we lovingly speak the truth, we will grow up completely in our relationship in Christ, who is the head. In verse 16, he makes the whole body fit together and unites it through the support of every joint. As each and every part does its job, he makes the body grow. He makes the body grow. This is Jesus. He makes the body grow so that it builds itself up in love. In the Greek language, Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 through 16. 11 through 16, that's six verses, is one sentence. And again, I won't go through the punctuation, the commas, the semicolons, the colons, but there's, get this, it's one period. Okay? It's punctuation throughout. Some of them leave out the comma here and there, but it's one sentence. In fact, some of the translations put periods in. It's one sentence from 11 to 16. And this one sentence gives us a complete statement of how Jesus, the Son of God, gifts his church with leaders, apostles who will establish and organize churches, prophets who will preach the truth in the public square and hold the people and the church and the world accountable to what thus says the Lord. Evangelists who will engage people in their language, in their setting, and invite them to consider the good news of Jesus Christ. Pastors who will take care of the sheep and feed them and love them and heal them and give them consolation and direction. Teachers who will tap into the never-ending truth of God's word and keep the stream flowing and keep the water clear and enable and equip and arm the people to resist the deniers and the liars and the deceivers and the manipulators. Leaders who are called, chosen, ordained, anointed to minister the grace and the forgiveness of the Son of God to broken people. Sometimes we think, I don't know, I think what we decide in the church, all the broken people out there, we all fix. This is the design of the church that Jesus presides over. Jesus came. Jesus showed us how to do it. Jesus went back to heaven. Jesus gave us the authority. This is what this church belongs to, Jesus. The healing is Jesus. The preaching is Jesus. The teaching is Jesus. It's not your church. And we are accountable to the Son of God for our leadership, for our assignment, for our vocation. The saints are broken people who have met Jesus. And once we meet Jesus, once we confess our faith in Jesus, we love and we learn more and more about Jesus. When we stay focused on Jesus, we will grow in unity and faith. Jesus has a way of uniting people across all kinds of boundaries and barriers. There's so many things that would separate us, so many things that would make us fight and argue and disagree. But Jesus, the light of Jesus is so strong. And the presence of Jesus is so real that when Jesus is in the room, in our worship, in our focus, in our thinking, in our longing, then we are united in faith. And we have the boldness then to speak the truth in love. Sometimes we sort of slant that speaking the truth in love and say, well, you're just supposed to love everybody. You're supposed to love everybody, but sometimes you got to tell the truth. And we get confused, say, well, if I love you, I'm not going to tell the truth. No, you speak the truth. Speak the truth in love. Build up. Grow up. Fit in. And do your job. That's our kingdom assignment. That's what the Son of God set the church up to do. And this scripture, this sentence shows us what it looks like. It's a lot of moving parts. Everybody's not at the same level. Everybody's not at the same place. But we are measuring up to what we saw Jesus do, what he did when he's on earth, and what he has appointed for us to do to grow in our kingdom assignment. More about Jesus would I know. More of his grace to others show. More of his saving fullness see. More of his love who died for me. More about Jesus let me learn. More of his holy will discern. Spirit of God, my teacher, be showing the things of Christ to me. More and more about Jesus. More and more about Jesus. More of his saving fullness see. More of his love who died for me. God, we thank you for your word. Thank you for your truth. Thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who showed us, taught us. When he was on this earth, he fulfilled his assignment, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, teaching the people the truth from the scriptures, the word of God, healing all kinds of illnesses, and disabilities, all kinds of brokenness, being broken himself, so that in his suffering and death, we would find healing and hope. In his resurrection, in his ascension, in his mandate and commissioning of us to go and teach the world. God, we thank you for how your word is showing us who we are. Let your light shine on our churches, our congregations, the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ in our contemporary time. It's so easy to say this is too hard and we can't do this. So, but this is your church and you are Lord and you have all authority in heaven and in earth. And so God, we accept your authority to represent you on this earth, in this city, in this neighborhood. And enable us, we pray, to allow you to heal us, to mend all the tears in the fabric, to heal all the brokenness in our lives, in our relationships. So that even if we got a limp, we can walk in the light of your truth. Give us, God, clarity of assignment. And give us the faith to trust you as you unify us, as you love us. And God, give us a sense of urgency so that we will not be content to do all this loving and building and growing just in our own little group. But show us, God, how to proclaim the good news so that others can come and join us and participate with us We won't be preoccupied with their brokenness because we're trying to work on our own. Show us Jesus, the Son of God, who is alive and who will get all the glory if we do what the Word is instructing us to do. And so, God, we pray that your Word will have its impact on the saints, on the leaders, and on those who need to know that God loves them and that there's a place for them to fit in to the body of Christ. Give us that grace, that hospitality, that healing, and that openness is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. I trust the Word has been a blessing and a challenge to you today. And I commission you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to grow up. We got work to do. But we have a mandate. We have a promise. We have a great opportunity. And we're not going to let this harvest pass. Let's receive the benediction now to God, who is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us. Unto God be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. The blessings of God for the people of God. Amen. I ask that you remain seated and we can be orderly in our dismissal. We are still vigilant and request that you take your conversations outdoors and not in the corridors and not congregating on the inside as we continue to trust the Lord to keep us safe. God bless you. Have a blessed day and a blessed week in the name of the Lord.
Of the universe, I am the one who spoke into nothing, and all creation heard. I am he who has all power in my hands, and if you believe on my word, you can stand. I am healer, mender of broken hearts, Alpha Omega, your destiny and where you start. I am the one who does impossible things. Who I am, just let me be who I am to you. That's who I am, just let me be who I am for you. I am the one who sees a need and always provides. I am the one whose name is a tower where you can run and hide. I am he who has all power in my hands, and if you believe on my word, you can stand. of all things. That's who I am. Just let me be who I am for you. And if there's a need,
I am.
When you are sick,
I am.
You're overwhelmed in the moment right now,
but I am.
You can't see your way,
I am.
Ooh, that's who I am.
That's who I am.
Just let me be. Let me be who I am to you.